Welcome back to Reading Bear.
Today, we will take a look at some new entitled parent stories.
And if you enjoyed my content, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel and post some bear emojis in the comments. Let's go!
The first one is titled, M pulls me over because I'm not wearing a helmet and I'm speeding on a bike. Then tries to steal my bike. Okay, just to start things off, this is my first time posting in this subreddit and I figured I'd share one of my most recent encounters with an entitled mother. About a year ago I got a brand new SE bike. The bike itself is worth about $1,000. And I love it so much. A week after I got the bike, I decided to bike to the nearest 711, which was about a mile away. On my way there, I was biking at a fast speed because I wanted to get there and get home fast. Now, whenever I speed up, I make sure there are no cars on the road because I don't want to hit any. So, out of nowhere, this woman runs into the middle of the road and started screaming, "Stop," over and over in the most loudest voice I've ever heard in my life. Even one of the neighbors' dogs started barking. So, I'm still going fast and her stopping in the middle of the road causes me to come to a complete stop and I nearly fell off bike. Now, my memory of the dialogue is pretty hazy but here is what I can remember. So, enter the cast, me, M, entitled mother, MK, mother's kid, PF, poor father, and finally, D, driver. So, I stopped not far from where M stood. I was confused because I thought something had happened. But then she started walking over to me. M, do you have any idea how fast you're going? Me, yeah. M, don't, yeah, me, you could have hit someone like my child. Her child was on the front yard playing with her friend. Me, ma'am, no one is on the road except for you, and how could I possibly hit your child? At this point she was pissed and in my face. M, don't you get smart with me boy. My child or someone else could have easily ran into the road and get hit by you. Now I was pissed. Some random woman just called me boy and was screaming in my face. Me, excuse me? There is literally no one else on the road except for you. After I said that, M's kid started to run towards her. She looked like she was about 8 years old. MK, mommy, please stop arguing and come and play with us. M, ugh, no. Go get your father and maybe he will play with you. MK, fine. MK said that in a depressed tone and I felt really bad for her, but shortly after MK ran into her house and her friend sat there waiting. Me, is that how you really treat your kid? You just turned her down. M, don't tell me how I should raise my kid boy. Maybe I should tell your parents how to train you properly. Now I was livid. Me, maybe you should learn how to have respect for others instead of treating them like crap. And my parents taught me properly unlike yours. Now, she was red in the face. She was a ticking time bomb waiting to explode. M, don't you swear in my neighborhood boy. My parents raised me right unlike yours. You should be wearing a helmet while you bike. Now, logically I should have been wearing a helmet because they increased the age limit where I live. But from what I heard, more than half of the cops just let it slide. Me, I'm sorry, but are you my parent? You have no control over what I do. And secondly, this is not your neighborhood. Now there was a car honking at us repeatedly from behind M. Shortly after, M flipped off the driver. Now, one thing to note is that the roads were pretty narrow because of all the cars that were parked in the street, so the driver couldn't just move around us. After M flipped off the driver rolled down his window. D, excuse me, but can you both please move aside? I need to pass through. I was shocked he was so calm about M just flipping him off. M, you can't tell me what to do. Asterisk now pointing at me, I'm trying to teach this inconsiderate piece of poop on how to not to steal from people like me. I was dumbfounded and confused. Not only did she curse in her neighborhood, but she literally changed the subject. She went from trying to tell me to not speed and how I should wear a helmet to how I stole something from her. Me, what did I? M cut me off. M, you stole my daughter's bike. Turns to driver, sir, please get my bike back. Now, it clicked in me. M wanted to get the driver on her side because he didn't know what had happened and so she wouldn't look like the fool. D turns to me and says, young man, please give M the bike back. He said it in the most sternest voice I had ever heard. Now I really wanted to just book it and run, but then MK came out and ran to M. MK, mommy. M cut off her own kid. M, boy. Give my daughter her bike back now or I'm calling the cops. MK cut off her own mother. MK, dad was right about you. You're a liar, that's not my bike that's. M put her hand over MK's mouth to shut her up. MK started to cry and struggled to break free. The driver rushed out of his car and started to pull M away from MK. M lets go of the child and slapped the driver on the right on the face. He even backed up and held his cheek. MK then ran inside crying and her friend followed. Now, I would have helped but I didn't want to get involved in anything. If the kid was being choked and was actually about to die, then I would for sure help. D, what duck is wrong with you? M, don't touch me. M started heading towards me but PF came through the front door. He called out M's name and she turned to him almost instantly. PF, M. Stop this right now. We're done. Get the duck inside the house right now and leave these people alone. His voice was loud and stern. M looked like she was about to cry. M, what? PF, don't, what me, get inside right now. M, but. PF, now. And with that, M ran inside covering her face with her hands. MK ran outside with her friend and they went back to having fun. The driver and I walked over to PF who had calmed down by now. PF, I'm so sorry you both had that happen to you. I was thinking of filing a divorce with her and now I will. Guys, if you need money for anything that she damaged, I'll be more than happy to pay for it. The driver and I both declined the offer. D, don't worry about me, I'm fine. Kid, I'm sorry I believed her and yelled at you. Me, it's all good man, don't worry about it. So, after that, I just biked home. My parents asked me what took so long and why I didn't buy anything. I just told them that I went to my friend's house. If I told them what had happened then my parents would probably never let me bike again. Moral of the story, don't try to lie your way out of a situation. It's a very bad idea that might result in dire consequences. The next one is titled, Entitled Mum Threatened to Sue Me, Forced Me to Find Her Son's Missing Teeth After He Tried to Drown Me. So this story comes from about 16 to 17 years ago when I was about 7 to 8 years old. Some details might not be word for word given the time and age difference. During the summer, my parents would send me off to a day camp at a local water park called Water World, which has been closed for the past few years. Its main attraction was the large outdoor pool, the rope swing, the raft slide, and the shotgun slide. The place was a real dump, and by all accounts should have been condemned. The sidewalks would get so hot that they would burn your feet, there was almost no shade, and we would be forced to walk across it constantly for camp activities while barefoot. The volleyball court next to the large pool had wasps living in the sand every year. The wooden structures were all moldy, including the support beams for some of the water slides, especially the raft one that was 3 stories tall. One of the pool's slides was permanently shut down due to serious injury, and the surrounding woods were filled with dumped appliances and several broken down and rusted out vehicles that we children would play on and around when we were told to go play in the woods by our lazy minimum wage teenage camp counselors. To exhaustively explain how much of a dump this place was, my fondest memory of the place is when I saved my friend's little brother, who was 5 at the time, from a swarm of wasps after he apparently threw a car battery on top of their nest to see what would happen. Let that sink in. Anyways, on with the story. I was swimming in the shallow end of the pool with a few of my friends at the time while waiting for our parents to pick us up when a larger kid, probably around 13 years old, the age limit for the camp, came over and started dunking me under the water. At first I thought it was just him messing around but for some reason he kept dunking me under the water trying to get some sick entertainment out of it. This went on for several minutes. None of the lifeguards were paying attention and the same went for the camp counselors. At one point, I said to myself, I'm going to drown if this goes on any longer, I have to do something. I immediately got a grip on the bottom of the pool and jumped up as forcefully as I could, headbutting back into his face in an attempt to break free. I apparently broke 3 of his teeth loose and, in the chaos that immediately followed, I got away. I didn't care about the kid, I just wanted to get out of the pool, so I went to a counselor and told them that the kid and I got into a fight. Fighting at the camp was fairly normal because the counselors openly didn't care at all. The counselor went to see if the kid was okay after making me wait in a nearby building, and I didn't hear back from them for some time. After about 15 minutes or so, this tall woman barges into the building with the counselor in tow. Enter the entitled mother, M. M, are you the little crap that hit my son? Me, what? The counselor walked away at this point with a not my job kind of attitude, while M grabbed me with both hands, repeating, did you hit my son? I tried to tell her what happened, he was drowning me and nobody would help, but M, that's bullcrap. My son was just playing with you and your friends, and you hit him. He would never hurt anyone, let alone drown them. He's missing teeth now. M then gestured to the pool, where the kid I had head-butted was still waiting in the shallow area, gauze in his mouth. M, you're going to go help him find his teeth, then you're going to UV and I'll be suing your family for the damages, including the lifelong trauma and quality of life problems you've given my son. I kept saying things like, but he was trying to kill me, or, it's not my fault he wouldn't let go, but in M's mind her son could do no harm and I was the devil child who dared to fight back. The whole time, I was still being held and shaken back and forth by M. I actually was forced by both the entitled mum and a counselor to look around in the pool with the entitled kid for about 15 minutes for his missing teeth until my dad drove in to pick me up. I'm sorry to say I missed the conversation that unfurled between the entitled mum and my dad as it happened in the parking lot, but suffice to say I didn't go to UV, we weren't sued, and I never heard from M or her son again. We stopped going to that camp a year later. The next one is titled, My Sister-in-Law Tried to Hijack My Son's Birthday for Her Gender Reveal Party. My husband and I have two children, both boys, now aged 11 and 14. My husband's younger sister now has three children aged 7, F, 5, M, and 3, M. The year my youngest son, let's shorten to YS for the story, was turning 4, he asked for a birthday party. He was not yet in school and so he did not know anyone but family and there were no children other than his brother that were able to attend. Luckily, his favorite people in the world are Grandpa and G-Ma, Dad's parents. G-Ma is like a big kid. She's super fun and energetic. She acts much like a kid herself and my boys adore her. I knew they were very busy so I asked them several months in advance if they could attend his birthday party. The party was to be on his birthday, this is important. Being the wonderful grandparents they agreed and requested that time off from their jobs. We also invited all close by family, including my Sil, the entitled mother of the story. Months go by and it's now about a week and a half before my son's big day. I've bought the decorations, planned the menu and pumped him up. I like to sing a final countdown song as I prepare breakfast in the morning. One afternoon I receive a call from my Sil who is about to find out the sex of her baby. She's pregnant with baby number one. She wants to plan a gender reveal party, but she's called her friends and family and discovered that most work and can't attend without several weeks' notice for their jobs. The only day everyone just so happens to have off is my son's birthday. Would I be willing to move my son's birthday party to another day so she can have her party? At this point it may bear mentioning that she already has three baby showers planned and has asked me to make the food out of pocket for one of the showers. Most people being asked to attend her gender reveal party were already attending multiple baby showers for her. I am pretty friendly and passive, this caught me very off guard. I tried to gently tell her that my son was looking forward to this and we've had it planned for months, which is why everyone had it off from work. She feigned sympathy but still urged me to please move my son's birthday party to a time that everyone could later attend, and let her have this open date for her party for her first baby, while you've already had two. Besides, YS loves babies and would want to go to her party too. He could still come to my party and see everyone he loves, and then get to do it all over again when everyone can request time off. I didn't have time to gather a response as she steamrolled over me saying, okay? If they want to go, I won't make them come to YS's party, but I can't go to your party. We have plans, and her responding, thanks. I was angry. She had pulled this kind of thing with other people before, I have tons of stories, but she had always really loved my boys and never tried this with me, or not to this extreme anyway. I didn't know how to react other than vent to my husband, her brother, who wasn't surprised at all and said not to worry and that their dad would set her straight. Funny enough, I was talking to my husband when I saw him, Phil, calling my phone. I answered and he said that my Sil had told him I had no problem with her hijacking my son's birthday and I had insisted she have the party and everyone go to that one instead of YS's. He said if this was true that he would attend her party, but he would way rather go to the party of YS. He'd already gotten presents and they were excited about celebrating a kid that's already here on his big day. I very happily told him that I was never going to cancel his birthday or make him sit through someone else's party on his big day. I mean, he's 4 and I've been counting down for him every morning. What kind of monster would I be? I said that I had told Syl that people could go to that if they preferred, but that we wouldn't be attending. He said that sounds about right and told her he's going to YS's party since he requested time off for that, and if she wants another party another day to give him notice. She cancelled, or never organised, the party and then talked about me behind my back to anyone that would listen for years to follow. The next one is titled, Entitled Aunt Claims We Have a Poltergeist Rather Than Admit That Her Kid Destroyed My Things. This happened a few years ago now, so though I do remember the sequence of events, conversations are a bit fuzzy. Also, kind of a longish story. So, the story requires some background. My aunt, the entitled's aunt in question, who I'll just refer to as K, has 3 sons, who were 1, 5, and 8, C, at the time of this story. The younger 2 don't play much of a part in this story. K is and always was emotionally abusive, and willingly sat by and watched as her husband, D for Dick, was physically abusive to her and her children. Over the course of about 15 years, she was on and off with D and always said she was going to leave him but never did, and always went back in the end. Almost every single time she left, she always came crawling back to my mother and father seeking salvation, and they always begrudgingly welcomed her back. When this story takes place, Kay had once again left D, promising that she was leaving for the final time, and my family took her and her boys in. Things were off to a bad start immediately, and there were multiple events leading up to the poltergeist fiasco. The first event happened when I went into the restroom and saw that an expensive lipstick of mine was smeared over the mirror and sink, and the actual tube was destroyed. I am by no means a beauty guru or anything like that, however, I think I'm pretty decent at make and have a small collection. I tend to buy pretty cheap products, but I have a few choice things that are relatively pricey, and all of which have been gifts. The lipstick in question was about $50 and had been a gift from a deceased friend, and it was honestly a bit sentimental. I completely understand that kids will be kids, and stuff like this is bound to happen, so I think when stuff like this happens, what you should do is sit down your kid and tell them that stuff like that isn't okay, right? Well, no, apparently not. Prior to this, Kay had always had the, my child can do no wrong, mentality, so I was already expecting her to avoid blame or to not do anything, but I thought I should address it anyway. I went and told her that one of her kids had destroyed an expensive lipstick of mine, and that, though I know kids will be kids, I'd appreciate it if she had a word with them about not touching my things. Immediately, she was adamant that her children would never do something like that and that it must have been our great-grandmother N, who lived 3 stories down and can't climb stairs. Later I learned that she went and cried to my grandmother, G, who is also extremely entitled, claiming that I hate her and her children and that I like to blame them for everything. Her boys had been prone to destroying, stealing things in the past and had been caught red-handed multiple times. This annoyed the ever-loving crap out of me to say the least, so I asked my mum to talk to her and I let it slide. About a week later, my oldest cousin, C, went upstairs to use the restroom and was in there for a remarkable amount of time. I went up about 5 minutes after he'd left and found the exact same lipstick smeared everywhere again, some brushes literally chopped to pieces, and a limited edition palette ripped apart and scattered everywhere. Should note that at this point I hadn't actually found the tube of the lipstick this time, and I assumed he'd taken it or thrown it away. Another week or so later I found it shoved into a bag of pads with an expensive, lipstick-covered watch. I went and got Kay to show her the scene, and she was once again positive that it couldn't have been her son, even though he'd locked himself in there for almost an hour. She then got upset and said that I blamed everything on her kids, etc. And that it was probably N before going and crying in her room, literally left all 3 children alone downstairs and expected us to watch them. I went directly to my mum because I was honestly pissed, and I asked her to deal with it before I blew up at Kay. She said she would, and she had a talk with Kay about discipling her sons later that night. The next day is when it starts to get fun. I went into the kitchen to find Kay standing there looking dejected and visibly drunk. She sighed and said, I'm sorry about your makeup, but it honestly wasn't C. She then went on about how he hadn't left her side all day that day, which everyone knew was false, and then looked me dead in the eyes and said, I think we have a poltergeist, and I think it's targeting C for some reason. She went on for about 10 minutes talking about every single thing he or his brothers had done, insisting that it had never been them all along, and it had always been this ghost. I was absolutely floored. Whether ghosts are real or not, whatever, but I can damn assure you that if we'd had a poltergeist, I would have known about it. Honestly, I wasn't looking for a fight this day, and I just rolled my eyes and went back upstairs. Later, G came to me furious saying that I was being absolutely horrible to Kay and that I'd made her cry. I got upset at this point and said that I wasn't going to let her manipulate me because she's too damn stupid and entitled to admit her son had destroyed my things. Kay heard this from upstairs and called my mother to say that I was treating her horribly and that her son hadn't even done anything wrong. Unfortunately, this sequence of events only persisted for about a month and only continued to get worse. While all of this was playing out, Kay and the kids were making everyone's lives living hell in multiple ways, and completely overtook and destroyed our house, even though she was no more than a guest. The final straw in this scenario was when I had found two lipsticks and a very sentimental necklace absolutely destroyed and torn apart after C had spent another hour in there. I lost my ducking mind and went immediately to Kay and called her out for C's constant behavior and that if she didn't put a stop to it I would lose my absolute crap with her. For about an hour or two she paced around the house exclaiming about how we were all horrible and mistreating her and blaming everything on her kids when it couldn't possibly have been them and how it's a poltergeist and that we're all just skeptics even though this supposed poltergeist has been terrorizing them for years. I just had to sit through all of this because she wouldn't let me speak. Then, she legitimately called an exorcist. She exclaimed to him that we're being terrorized by a poltergeist and that it's targeting her child and that now she's probably going to be kicked out and put on the street over some goddamn lipstick that her son didn't even destroy and so much more. This whole situation just blew my ducking mind, and I just sat there and listened and watched as she victimized herself and completely crap-talked me and my family to this exorcist. Eventually my mother stepped in and put a stop to the madness, and I don't know exactly what happened after that. I know that my mum went off on her at the very least. Over the next few days Kay completely ignored us and wouldn't even address what happened, before one day when she stopped me on the way out of the house and mumbled a sort of snarky apology. In the end my makeup never got replaced and I never really got a substantial apology, but I was less upset about the monetary value and overall just the principle of things. Kay and the kids moved out about 2 months later because Dee got out of prison. She moved back in later that year after leaving Dee again, and then last year moved out to get back with Dee again. Since then, Kay pretty much destroyed her relationships with everyone and we've all since cut contact, and she is never welcome back in our lives. I will finish this off by saying that I love my cousins dearly, and if I get so much as a hint that they're still being abused, I will go through hell and back to get them out of there. As far as I can tell, the abuse, physical and emotional, has stopped, but I plan to get social services involved the second I hear if something goes wrong. I don't blame my cousins for anything, and at the end of the day they're still just kids with crappy ducking parents, and honestly, they're good kids and I wish I could have been there for them more. I have a myriad of entitled parent stories revolving around my aunt besides this one, and maybe I'll tell them in the future as well. The next one is titled, M Goes 5-Year-Old in Front of Everyone. I work for a large US airline and it was a couple weeks before Christmas, so it's crazy with thousands of people in the terminal. I'm working the gate for a flight to LAX and everyone has boarded with the exception of an unaccompanied minor. When they came the parents have to accompany the child at all times until we take them on the aircraft. They are supposed to board first so we can get the child settled in and explain what is going to happen. Now I know for a fact that the parents checked in over 2 hours before the flight departed, so tons of time. Well, I see that they aren't here, so I make a terminal page and go out of my way and even call the number listed, nothing. Okay, close the flight so it can go to its destination. While the flight is getting ready to leave I'm doing my paperwork and a woman walks up and says we're here. Keep in mind there is only one adult woman. I tell her that the flight is closed and is leaving. M, no it's not, she's not on it yet. Me, I'm sorry but it's too late and we can rebook it for tomorrow. M, no, it's not supposed to leave until 7:35 p.m. Me, yes, it's 7:37 and the gate closes 10 minutes early. 7:35 is when it leaves the gate. M, well call it back, she has to be on that flight. At this time I smell the alcohol on her breath. Me, I'm sorry, we held it as long as possible and it had to leave. I'll be happy to book it for tomorrow. I can now see anger is flowing on her face. She turns around, takes 5 steps to the hallway in front of everyone, drops to her knees and screams at the top of her lungs, holding her hands in the air. Total platoon movie moment. Everyone is looking at her now. I'm documenting what she is doing to cover our rear ends, fully knowing this is normal behavior for LAX. At this time her wife and the child shows up and she throws me under the bus. She won't let you on the aircraft to see your grandma. At this time the child is crying and the original mother is just laying into me, swearing every word under the sun. I hope you feel good that you're not letting her go to Disney now. I'm sorry, but you were here over 2 hours ago. We told you that she's boarded first and when boarding started. Would you like me to rebook for tomorrow? Other mum kicks in. Please, do that for tomorrow and what time is it? Same time. I give them all the usual stuff they need and say do the same process you did today and send them on their way. Next day, I'm at the gate, in plain clothes as I'm taking the trip today. I see the same M come to the gate counter and demanded to know who her daughter is going to be sitting next to. The agents say we're not allowed to give that out, but she wouldn't hear that. I finally step up and say, she's sitting next to me, right by the other flight attendants so we can watch them. We have specific places for minors for this reason. She realizes that she's not going to get anywhere so the child boards. The rest of the flight gets on, I get upgraded to first class and all is well. We arrive in LAX and I see the grandmother there to pick up the child and apologize to her for being a day late and hope that it doesn't ruin her Disney vacation. She's all happy and says oh, it's all good, we aren't going till the following day. It was going to be grandparents' boating time, thanks me for being concerned and off she goes. Thank you for watching the video. Please don't forget to subscribe to the channel, like the video and write a comment.